So the idea of using signals for state management and UI updating was already introduced by Vue when Vue.js version 3 was released in 2020. Now, the signals pattern was of course not necessarily pioneered by Vue, but they were the first major framework to actively use signals for UI updates. Though in Vue, signals were called refs. Still, the idea was the same. You could set up a ref, then refer to it in your template, and whenever you then change such a ref value, that place in the UI where the signal is used will automatically get updated. That's the idea behind signals. And signals then became really popular, even though Vue was using them right from the start, when SolidJS embraced them. Even though SolidJS is actually a smaller front-end JavaScript framework, but nonetheless, it made signals really popular. Maybe because they weren't called signals in Vue, or they didn't market them aggressively enough, whatever. So SolidJS made the concept of fine-grained reactivity, where only the parts of the UI that really changed are updated when data changes, super popular, and suddenly everyone wanted to use signals. For example, Angular also introduced signals. Now you can still use Angular the way you always did, and signals, at the point of time where I'm recording this, aren't even fully implemented yet. There still are some features missing which they want to add, but still, Angular now also has signals, and you can use signals to manage your state and get Angular to update your UI. Svelte, for example, also introduced runes, which are their signals for UI update management. So signals clearly are everywhere. And why is that? Well, that's the case because of this fine-grained reactivity they allow those frameworks to offer with such a signal-based approach. And that, of course, can lead to a higher efficiency and better performance. But how do signals actually work? That's what I want to take a look at here now. And for that, we're simply going to build our own basic signal. Now, in a nutshell, a signal is simply some data and some function that may update that data combined with a list of subscribers who are interested in data changes so that those subscribers can be notified whenever the data changes. Therefore, if we want to build our own very basic signal library that of course does not have the same amount of features Vue or Angular have, we can start by creating a function that manages some data and that then creates two internal functions, so functions inside of the function. One function that will simply return the latest data, and one function that can be used to set that data to a new value. Now, you might wonder why we need a function for getting that signal value and why we don't just return that value, and I'll get back to that in a second. And then from our create signal function, we return those two functions, the function for reading the signal and the function for setting the signal value. In addition, in that create signal function, we also accept an initial value so that we can set this internally managed data to an initial value. And then we can use the create signal function to create multiple signals with their own data. And we can use the read function to read those values and the set function to update those values. And then we can read the updated values. So that works. But at this point, we don't really have any reactivity yet. When we set the signal to a new value, the places where we're using it are not notified. And that's what we can therefore change by also managing a list of subscribers, which could be a simple array or a set, whatever. Now, with that subscribers array set up, we can go to that read function and then in there actually push a new subscriber onto that subscribers array. And that's why this read function must be a function and why we don't directly return the signal value in the create signal function. Because we need to know who's reading and we need to add that thing, that place in our code to the subscribers. Though at the moment we're not adding any value yet, and I'll get back to this in a second. Let's assume though we would add something here. In that case, we of course would want to notify all subscribers whenever the signal value changes. And that's therefore what we do in that set function. There we simply iterate through all subscribers, and then we assume that every subscriber is a function we can call to let that subscriber know that the signal value changed and that it should again do whatever it wants to do with that signal. So our assumption is that a subscriber is a function in the end, and we need to add that subscriber function when we read a signal. How do we do that? Well, we could accept it as an argument in the read function, and that would be a valid way of implementing it, but that way, every time we read the signal, we would have to pass a function to that read function, which is then that subscriber function that will be called when the signal is updated. But that's not necessarily the best way of implementing it. Instead, what's typically done is that you create a separate effect function, which then can be used to wrap any code that reads a signal, so that you can again read without passing a function to your read function. Because the idea now simply is that this effect function takes a function that should be re-executed every time the read signal changes. And that's achieved by, inside of that effect function, updating some global variable and setting that global variable equal to the effect function, then calling read. And in the read function, we then reach out to that global variable to get the currently executing effect function, and we add that currently executing effect function, which is stored in that global variable, to that subscribers array. By doing it like this, we can then use this effect function how often we want in our code to register a function that will re-execute whenever the signal that's being read inside of it is changing. Now that read function here will be executed and will add this effect to its subscribers because it's that read function that's executed in the effect function. And we make sure that this effect function gets executed after updating this global variable. Therefore, the effect function executes, in there the read function executes, and that read function reaches out to that global variable, which refers to that effect function that's currently being executed, and adds it to the list of subscribers. And that's how we can make sure that all these effect functions we're executing are getting added to the list of subscribers. And that is how we could implement our own basic signals library. Now, of course, as mentioned, those frameworks are, of course, a bit more advanced and do this in a bit of a more efficient way and also offer extra features. They, for example, also allow you to use a signal in a template and they automatically wrap it by such an effect function for you. But in a nutshell, if you wanted to build your own very basic signal library, that's how you could do, and that is how signals in the end work under the hood.